Geneva Overholzer. I'm very pleased to be your host for the 2013 Walter Cronkite Award for Excellence in Television Political Journalism. The first ceremony in 2001 was here in Washington as well, and I know some of you were involved in that ceremony are here. So this is a bit of a homecoming. And one of the judges for those first awards, Kathleen Hall Jameson, is here today as a presenter for a new award. But more about that in a moment. I'm also joined today by one of my USC Annenberg colleagues, Judy Muller, who will share with me the honor of presenting the rest of the trophies. Some of you may notice that someone is not here today, someone who is always here for the Cronkite Awards, and that is our colleague, Marty Kaplan, director of the Norman Lear Center. Marty has hosted all the previous awards and symposia, but this year he was asked to deliver a memorial lecture for a dear colleague in Barcelona. So he is there, but he is here in spirit with us too. There are two other people I want to take a moment to thank. First, the namesake of these awards, Walter Cronkite, whose distinguished career, tough journalistic standards, and love of American democracy still inspire television reporting. And second, Norman Lear, whose generosity drives the Lear Center's work. Thanks to both of these gentlemen. The Lear Center and the Annenberg School for Communication and Journalism at the University of Southern California initiated the Cronkite Awards in 2001 to honor exceptional television political journalism every other year, cleverly timed to fall on national election years. To begin, I'd like to introduce Kathleen Hall Jameson, director of the Annenberg Public Policy Center at the University of Pennsylvania, to present the first new award, and a good friend as well.
And a co-author as well. I'd like to add to Geneva's list of thanks one more. The Omidyar Network's Democracy Fund made possible those lovely ads that congratulated all of you on your accomplishments. And I hope you saw the ads in the New York Times and the Washington Post. They also helped support this luncheon. So please join me in a round of applause in thanking Tom Glaser and Joe Bowen. This year, we're inaugurating the Cronkite Jackson Award, which is named for Brooks Jackson, who's the founding director of FactCheck.org, which is a project of the Annenberg Public Policy Center of the University of Pennsylvania. The University of Pennsylvania's Annenberg Public Policy Center convened a special panel for this award, and I'd like to recognize the members of the panel, Jim Drinkard, Eugene Kiley, and Cindy Kennard. They had a tough job. We got applications from all over the country. They were really outstanding applications. And among them, we found what we think are the very best and the best. But before we go to the best of the best, I'd like to talk the best of the best of the best, and that's Brooks Jackson, to pay tribute to his life's work, which is only beginning. In the fact-checking enterprise, we have put together a brief celebratory film.
They have me checking the truthfulness of political ads. You got it.
CNN special assignment correspondent Brooks Jackson ran a fact check.
A questionable connection. We asked the man who made the ad to explain.
What the Democrats showed
was not a crisis.
Was extremely misleading.
It distorted the facts.
That Bush ad is misleading. Not the whole story. False.
But when those ads give misleading information, we'll be watching.
In 2004, we took this process a step further with AnnenbergFactCheck.org. Christopher Conkey of the Wall Street Journal wrote, "The site is becoming the place to look when a voter or reporter hears something come from a candidate's mouth that just doesn't sound right."
Brooks Jackson has been director since the project started in 2003.
What we do at FactCheck.org is apply the standards of journalistic accuracy to the claims made by candidates and in their ads. If I would fire a reporter for turning in copy like this ad, I'll call it false.
So how do you know which campaign is stretching the truth? That's where our Power Player of the Week comes in.
So Brooks, I'm glad to have you with us because there's a lot of misinformation out there.
We love to debunk false political claims, and I don't care which team's pitching. If I get a big fat one, we'll knock it as far as we can.
My station, and I know myself, we stand on the shoulders of what Brooks Jackson has done and UPenn, and I thank them so much because it's legitimized it.
Factcheck.org.
Yeah, our partners at FactCheck.
Our partners at FactCheck found it to be
peppered with exaggerated, misleading,
and just plain false claims.
I wanted to know what the senator from North Carolina was referring to, so I went and got FactCheck.org.
And I would ask to be made part of the record, the FactCheck.org.
Our job is to give those readers who are interested some place to go to sort through the inevitable distortions and confusion.
Keeping them straight on both sides. Thanks, Brooks.
And I'd like to say thanks, Brooks, as well, because as Emeritus Director, Brooks is going to continue to write for FactCheck.org, and he's going to make that commitment personally to you when he comes up now to say a few words.
Never gives up trying to get me to work for factcheck.org, it's true. But I finally achieved emeritus status. I said in our family newsletter, that's Latin for washed up. It was a joke. The script for this thing says Brooks will speak for 3 minutes. I want to check that. I'm going to speak for less. I just want to say, first of all, that it kind of makes feelings about having an award named for me, even though I'm still vertical. And now I'm seeing my life flash before my eyes. It's kind of a spooky feeling. But getting beyond that, I am really deeply honored by having an award named for me, and I am extremely pleased to be part of what was the word just used? Validating the work of others in this area, which I think without question has expanded beyond anything I expected, and certainly beyond anything previous. And this last campaign was certainly the most fact-checked campaign ever. Not that it made the candidates any more truthful, but that's the wrong measure. Don't look at that for validation. I do think that made voters better informed, those voters who wanted to be informed, not all of you, and gave them a good place to go. And I want to thank Kathleen for supporting this enterprise, Eugene, Lori, Rob, D'Angelo Gore, the factcheck.org staff, present staff, past staffers. This is not a one-person operation by any means. It's very gratifying to me, though, to see other news organizations picking this up and doing this in their own way. Some have been doing it for a long time, for as long as we have, but it's as an enterprise checking the disinformation that political campaigns try to feed to voters is becoming a mainstream part of American journalism, and I think a necessary evolution in American journalism. And I'm just happy to be part of honoring others who carry on this work. Thank you all very much for coming.
The first Cronkite Jackson Award given to the local station in our judgment, did the best job for fact-checking political messages goes to Denver's KULSA. The judges were impressed by the commitment of reporting talent by this distinguished station, by its 44 truth tests, and by its on-air online synergy created not simply by posting online, but by posting online in a way that was visible and easily accessible to the people in this important battleground market. If the winners of the award could please step forward. Accepting on behalf of the Gannett-owned NBC affiliate, our KUSA's executive producer, Mark Yoder, and local reporter, Brandon Brinneman. Okay, now this says, someone hands trophy to Kathleen, who says congratulations, and a brief speech.
Well, we approve that message. Thank you very much. very much. It's a great honor and great honor to be here with Brooke Jackson as well. Thank you so much for having me. It's a fantastic award. I want to talk a little bit about how we did what we did, because it really was a commitment by KUSA. We actually hired three graduate students to be researchers, realizing well in advance of the cycle that we're going to have to staff up. Mark Yoder, our executive producer here, oversaw that group. He was involved heavily in recruiting them. We got three of the smartest people that we could find, and we worked them. So that's what allowed us to, you know, survive drinking from the fire hose, as I described. Hannah, Eddie, Emily Land, Emily Parker were those researchers. So I want to get their names on the record. And of course, thank the management at KUSA, news director Patty Dennis, Mark Cornetta, our general manager, and Tim Ryan, our assistant news director, all committed heavily to this very early on, and it's what allowed us to do what we did. Having that extra staff of researchers really allowed us to go through a three-level approach to doing these fact checks, where we have sort of the heavy lifting done by the researcher to really get an idea of what's behind the claims in the ad. Then it goes into a reporter's hands who will further research anything that needs to be researched, double check, put it in context, write a story off of that, and then folks like Mark Yoder or our assistant news director Tim Ryan would give it one final look, and we were very comfortable with the claims that we made to the point where I think we got challenged maybe two or three times out of those 44 ads, and it was splitting hairs type stuff when we cared. So thanks again. I want to thank everybody who's involved in this award. It's a great honor. Thanks, guys.
Now I'd like to show you a clip of their outstanding work.
We'll start with an ad that does that from the Romney campaign.
Obama has cut $716 billion from Medicare. Why? To pay for Obamacare.
Let's wind the video back a little bit and look at this claim, which is half true. The number comes from a Congressional Budget Office letter that said if you repealed Obamacare, you'd have to spend $716 billion more on Medicare. That's because Obamacare controls the future cost of Medicare by lowering the rates it pays to hospitals and insurance companies. You can construe that as cutting Medicare spending, but it's not a literal cut to the Medicare budget, and none of that cut is to benefits.
So now the money you paid for your guaranteed health care is going to a massive new government program that's not for you.
This claim is misleading. It leaves you with the impression that President Obama raided money from Medicare and spent it on a bunch of new health care programs. What Obamacare really did was keep Medicare costs from growing as quickly and use the savings to help get insurance for more people. The Obama campaign has a counter ad.
The nonpartisan AARP says Obamacare cracks down on Medicare fraud, waste, and abuse and strengthens guaranteed benefits.
Now, the AARP did say those things, but it's all opinion. These are the intentions of Obamacare, but many parts of it haven't become law yet, so we don't know it will do any of that.
And experts say Ryan's voucher plan could raise future retirees' costs more than $6,000.
This claim is unproven. The number is based on a study of an old Ryan plan, not his current one. The same study hasn't been done for his current plan, which would allow seniors to choose between traditional Medicare or a private plan. In other words, no mandatory vouchers. The bottom line here, neither campaign proposes cutting benefits for Medicare. They both want to control future costs, but in different ways, a debate that will have more impact on future seniors and almost none on the people who use Medicare today. With your truth test, Brandon Ritterman, 9 News.
You can see past truth tests that we have done on the political page at 9news.com.
Congratulations, KUSA. The national winner of the Cronkite Jackson Prize is CNN. Tom Foreman's in-depth reality checks effectively used 3D graphics to clarify the complexity of underlying issues, set the candidates' exchanges in historical context, and underscore corrections. Let's take a look.
Go to CNN's Tom Foreman. He has a reality check about what the candidates said on the sensitive issue of fixing illegal immigration. Tom?
The fundamental claim here is that the president promised comprehensive immigration reform and he produced no immigration reform. I want to look at the president's claim first, though, because it gets at something that Republicans have pushed beyond that. They've largely suggested that the president has not been interested in engaging this issue of illegal immigrants, and they point to things like this as evidence. These are numbers from the Department of Homeland Security from 2000 to 2011. And look what happened with immigration arrest. They were really quite high, 1.8% in 2000. Through the Bush years, they went a little bit up, a little bit down, generally down. But then look, you hit 2009, Barack Obama is in office, and they just go steadily, steadily down. Many Republicans want to point to that and say, look, this is evidence that he's pandering to the Latino vote. He doesn't want to be tough on illegal immigrants. But there's more to the picture. Look at this over here. This is what's happening to the people who are being arrested. This is the record of deportations from 2000 up until 2011. And look, they were quite low, but under Barack Obama, they have steadily risen. When you get to his time here, look, that was rising under George Bush. Here it is, 2009. This is the highest level that we've ever seen under any president in terms of deportations. Barack Obama embraced the policies of George Bush when it came to the border. He's increased funding for the border, more guards, more motion detectors and cameras, more drones and airplanes and helicopters, so much so that when you combine it with the economic changes that have made a lot of jobs here dry up, the Pew Hispanic Center says now we have a net illegal immigration in this country of about zero. So Barack Obama can properly say he has engaged the issue of illegal immigration. On the more narrow count, what Mitt Romney said about producing immigration reform, he is absolutely right on this. Barack Obama did promise he would have comprehensive immigration reform. He did not produce it. They did try to do something on the DREAM Act. He took some administrative action to try to help the children of people who are here illegally, but he did not produce legislation, although he says if he can be reelected, he will try it in his second term.
Congratulations, CNN. Congratulations, Tom Cotton.
Thank you all. Our table is a little thin because, as you probably noticed, there's a bit going on today, and we're sort of in the thick of it along with everybody else. Listen, here's the biggest fact that I know. This was a great political season for fact-checking, and we owe an enormous debt to people like Cal Reed, with whom we were doing this a while ago, when I was back at ABC with Nightline a long time ago. I know Judy and I were doing it way back then. Brooks, the way you have pioneered all of this, the work of the Annenberg School, and frankly, the work of all of you out here, because I think this whole fact-checking enterprise is only surviving because in institutions all across this country, people are fighting for it. Because it's easy for people to shy away from it, and I admire every one of you who helped fight for this and get it out there, get it on the air, and show the value of it, because I have no doubt about the extraordinary value of it. In terms of our, there's so many people we need to thank here. Obviously, to have an award that has Brooks' name on it and Walter Cronkite's name on it, that's very, very exciting and a wonderful thing. In terms of our team, I always have to thank our bureau chief, Sam Feist, Eric Shirley, people back there, Richard Griffiths, Kathy Strait, some of the cornerstones of our fact-checking team. One of our producers, Aaron Cooper, is out here. Eric Maripodi is here. And these three folks with Eric and our little group over here, this is something that excites me. Because these are really the people who did this. And that's a great excitement to us. We have our team in Atlanta who did fact-checking, which also mattered a lot. But to make all this work, it was Patrick Ford and Paula B. Reddy and Josh Braun who runs this effort, along with Eric. And that's what made the thing work. And we cannot be happier or more proud to receive this honor because we believe in fact-checking over there. We think it's the only thing that really, really matters in journalism. Get a story and get it right. And that's old-fashioned, no matter how much we dress it up. And thank you all very much. We appreciate it.
So congratulations, KUSA. Congratulations, CNN, and back to Geneva.
Thank you, Kathleen. We are so honored to have the
Cronkite Jackson Prize to be part of the Spanish Awards. It's such an extraordinary example for all of us. I wanted to note that the judges' names, and along with those of our many dedicated screeners, are in your program. They really gave a lot of time and care to their deliberations in order to produce this year's list of distinguished winners, so I want to thank them. I also want to recognize the Lear Center staff, Veronica Howricki, Adam Rogers, and Scott McGibbon. Could you join me in thanking the judges and the staff? And now back to the trophies. The next category is local broadcast station. And this year's winner is KARE-TV, Minneapolis-St. Paul. Judges were particularly impressed with its coverage of the marriage equality debate. In partnership with Minnesota Public Radio, reporters traveled the state interviewing citizens with diverse viewpoints and got to the core of this issue. KARE found thought-provoking viewpoints that propelled the story and informed the viewer. Let's watch the clip.
The Gay Marriage Amendment has deeply divided our state, pitting neighbor against neighbor and splitting families and churches.
But to get a complete picture of how the amendment is affecting real Minnesotans, we teamed up with Minnesota Public Radio News and took a road trip to five communities outside the Twin Cities: St. Cloud, Red Wing, Moorhead, Grand Rapids, and Granite Falls. Throughout the day on our newscast, we're going to take you to those towns for special reports. And we begin this morning with NPR News reporter Sasha Oslanian and Carol Levin photojournalist Deb Lingdahl in Granite Falls.
In the Twin Cities, it's hard to miss the signs, yards peppered with opinions. But head to the small community of Granite Falls, and the signs are more seasonal than controversial.
So we just tried to beautify Granite Falls.
The Ladies Slipper Garden Club agree on the vision for this garden. What the women disagree on lies just below the surface of this river town.
We believe the scripture that in creation, God created man, and he also created a woman to be stand beside him.
I don't think it should be in the Constitution, and I think we're giving up rights which people should have.
Granite Falls Mayor Dave Smagluski knows the people in his town are private, but still hold strong feelings about the amendment.
People tend to kind of keep these kind of questions pretty close to their vest, and I think you know, maybe because they know that there can be hurt feelings one way or the other.
Smagluski, who's also the publisher of the town's newspaper, is one of the most vocal opponents of the amendment.
There certainly are some gay folks living out here. Gay and lesbian population is pretty minimal. You know, I think it's a live and let be, live and let live kind of attitude that people have.
Democratic State Senator Lyle Coonan says he heard more conservative voices in his district. That's why he was one of only three DFLers to break with his party and vote to put the amendment on the ballot.
The message was pretty consistent that that's what the people at home expected.
Coonan said the people in his district wanted to vote on marriage, and the women of the Garden Club will do just that, without digging up too much controversy.
Somewhere, sometime, this is going to happen to most anybody's relatives, and we accept them. God wants us not to judge.
If there are other couples of the same sex that can live together and have no guilty conscience and still serve the Lord, then I guess the Lord would have to be their judge.
For NPR News and Care 11, I'm Sasha Aslanian in Granite Falls.
Yes, that brings back my Iowa days. This is the first win for KARE, a Gannett-owned NBC affiliate. Reporter Carla Holt is accepting on behalf of the state. Carla?
Thank you so much for this award, and we were so pleased Sasha's story was the one chosen to air there because it just highlights our partnership. We had several stories that day that were similar to that one that were throughout Minnesota, and it was part of our coverage, obviously, of this amendment. The coverage had other stories as well before and after the election. But just, we share this award so much with other people, and our talented photojournalist, Deb Lingdahl, and John Drilling traveled the state with us and did a remarkable job. Jennifer Young and Cindy Chapman were producers who worked hard on it back at the station. And we credit as well our news director, Jane Helmke, and her second-in-command, Stacey Nogi, who decided to make the commitment to this kind of a story, this kind of a project, and it was remarkable that they did that when you have to resist the temptation to get the news of the day out there as well. And it also is worthwhile to note that, again, Minnesota Public Radio and that opportunity to partner with them and their remarkable resources and respect within our community. I think we also have to credit our husbands because we have two children, both of us, and a three-year-old and a one-year-old in my case, and he was somewhat of a single father during the time of this particular project. And really, I would say that we probably both reserve our greatest gratitude to the amazing and courageous people who chose to weigh in and share the most personal and profound perspectives on what was ultimately a hugely controversial issue. And some of the stories that we didn't have a chance to see, we interviewed a mother whose son is gay and who was absolutely torn, conflicted by her conservative upbringing, her conservative family, and her loyalty to her son. We interviewed a Norwegian grandfather who had become an advocate and an activist, also torn by this particular issue, but was an advocate for his daughter, who happened to be gay. We talked to a doctor who had become the lone voice in his relatively small community in support of the amendment. And it just went to show that these people were courageous to have that kind of conviction and have that kind of bravery to let the wider community know how they felt about this controversial issue, knowing that there could be some kind of ramifications to that. So we are utmost grateful to them and for their time that they spent with us in front of the camera. And thank you again so much for honoring us.
In this same category, local broadcast station, the judges chose to give WBNS 10 TV, Columbus, Ohio, a special commendation for citizen engagement. Judges singled out the station's online interactive voter guide, created in partnership with the Columbus Dispatch and This Week Community News, which helped voters learn how the issues affected their lives personally. Judges also applauded WBNS for its Show You Care and Vote bus tour, which traveled to college campuses across the state. Let's take a look.
10TV is canvassing Central Ohio college campuses this week to remind everyone to vote. Our Show You Care and Vote bus will be coming to a campus near you. We stopped at Audubon University in Westerville from 11 to 1 today with voter information and registration forms. It's the first stop of our five-day tour.
And every district with a levy on the ballot next week has outlined to parents just what is at stake should the levy fail. But for one district, if its levy fails, the cuts will begin in less than 30 days.
The Statue of Liberty is over here, okay?
For students in the Licking Heights Local School District, today is a regular school day. But for parents like Brandy Epley, it's the last few days to get the word out about the district's levy.
It's very frightening, so I really hope that it passes.
Epley has two children in the district. While her son is focused on his own set of wheels, Epley is concerned about the students who could no longer have access to these wheels. If the upcoming emergency operating levy does not pass, the district will no longer bus high school students to school starting December 3rd.
The challenge for us is we have to balance the budget, and so we would actually lay off drivers, eliminate about 18 routes in the morning, 18 in the afternoon, and then we start to recapture some monies to balance the budget.
The other thing that could change is class size. According to the superintendent, right now a class size averages about 25 students. But if the levy fails, you're looking at a class size of more than 35 students.
And now that early voting is underway, 10TV wants to get you ready to cast your ballot. We've launched an interactive voter's guide with our partners at the Columbus Dispatch and This Week News. Here's how it works.
Log on to 10TV.com/votersguide. All you need is your address and zip code. With one simple click, you'll have your personalized ballot right in front of you. The guide includes contested races and ballot issues in Central Ohio. Want to compare candidates? You can read their biographies and see their responses to questions side by side.
The guide also helps you figure out how much proposed tax levies and issues will cost you. Just type in the assessed value of your house.
Once you're done, email or print yourself a copy of your choices to take with you when you vote.
Marshall Zellinger is here to accept this award for his work at KMGH, a Scripps-owned ABC affiliate. Marshall. I'm sorry, I got myself a little bit confused here. Yes, please forgive me. Accepting as the news director of WBNS 10 TV, Albert Tucker. Forgive me, Albert.
Congratulations, Marshall. This project for us began in 2011, and we really look forward to the political process in Ohio in 2012 for some very obvious reasons. As I mentioned on the panel, this started at the top with the highest levels of the company. I'd like to recognize the commitment from John F. Wolf, our chairman, Michael Fiorelli, our CEO, Tom Griesdorn, the president and general manager of WBNS-TV. And then to recognize our partners in the Voters Guide at the Columbus Dispatch and This Week News. Without them, we could not have done this, and it's a pleasure that this was a true collaborative effort across our company. I'd like to recognize Rochelle Young, Jim Heath, and Tracy Townsend, who formed the core of our political coverage during 2012. A lot of miles on the road, a lot of hours without sleep, and without you, we couldn't have done it, so I'm grateful. Thank you very much.
Please forgive me, WBNS. You guys deserve to be named correctly. That was wonderful work. Now, we've already given Marshall, no. Our next category is local station individual achievement. This year, we honor first-time winner Marshall Zellinger at KMGH Denver for his impeccably researched and substantive reporting, his balanced pinpoint truth-tracking tests, and for the visual clarity of his presentation. When his pieces were limited by time, he put extended explanations of issues and links to related information on the KMGH website. Let's have a look.
You're going to have to usually have some good reason for challenging the person.
We check state statute. Your age, your residency, and your citizenship can be challenged.
If someone's legal status is questioned, mm-hmm. is an election judge allowed to ask for proof of legal status?
The election judge and the clerk and recorder, they're empowered to resolve that, and as part of their resolution, they may ask for evidence. And that evidence may just be a sworn affidavit.
There's no requirement that you show proof, and in fact, that's something that gives us great pause, that there could be someone asking for proof at the polls.
We took a closer look at the statute. The election judges are only allowed to ask questions like, are you a citizen of the United States? Or, to the best of your knowledge and belief, are you 18 years of age or older? If the voter answers yes, they sign an affidavit and vote. If your vote is challenged and you refuse to answer the election judge's questions, you can still vote, but it would be a provisional ballot. Provisional ballots aren't counted until after all of the regular ballots. Now, if you are challenged incorrectly, there's no punishment for the person who did the challenging. Reporting live, Marshall Zellinger, 7 News.
7 News truth tracking the candidates' statements tonight, making sure that you know the facts, get them straight. 7 News reporter Marshall Zellinger tracking the debate tonight, and he's live with a spot check on what we heard. Marshall?
Mike, those face-to-face confrontations that Mark referenced led to some healthy debate over what's true and what's false, starting with the cost of filling up at the pump based as it relates to oil and gas production on federal lands.
In the last 4 years, you cut permits and licenses on federal land and federal waters in half.
Not true, Governor Romney.
This is misleading.
Permits are being approved, just at a lesser rate, not cut in half from where they were. This is data from the Department of Interior, and what we're looking at is this line, the number of drilling permits approved on federal land. I've come over here and I've already done the math. Over the last 3 years, while the president has been in office, there have been more than 12,800 permits approved to drill on federal land. Over the last 3 years of President Bush's term, there were more than 20,000. You can see there are still being permits issued, just not as much as those last 3 years under President Bush, and the difference isn't half. You can see it's about one-third fewer.
And And now, Marshall Zellinger is here to accept this award for his work at KMGH's Scripps on ABC. I tell you.
That's the clear difference between local television and CNN with the the budgets, I guess. We'll have to talk. In many different ways, I find it interesting that I'm getting a political journalism award. One, because my parents, who are sitting over there, will attest to this. I didn't talk until I was like 5 years old, so the fact that I'm in a profession where I have to talk, that's number one. I went to school for sports journalism and couldn't find a sports job, so my first job was in Chico, California, and my station was based in Reading, but they wanted someone to cover politics, and I was the closest person to Sacramento. So I used that as my advantage. Oh, I can go eat at a good restaurant, I can go to a bigger city, I'll check it out. And I was getting a tour of Sacramento State Capitol, or the California State Capitol in Sacramento, and one of our state senator press people gave me a tour. And he asked me, oh, did you always want to be a political journalist? And I think he was shocked, but I'm like, well, actually, I want to do sports. He's like, come here for a second. And he takes me into the assembly chambers. And he says, look up there. And it's the board where they take roll and take the votes. And he says, you see that? We have two different teams. We keep score. Every year you get your hopes up and somehow your team dashes it. And he's so right. Here I am now. I think my political background really came from Friday night dinners talking politics when I didn't even care about politics when I was 5 and 6 years old. Now that I do care, it's foreboding to talk about. I think I almost gave my grandfather a heart attack when I brought up the election for some reason. I need to thank a lot of people at work because I know this is an individual achievement award, but it is far from just an individual achievement. The truth checks. My executive producer probably had a few coronaries as I'm rushing to do a day-term truth check, especially on the debates, where I'm like, I've spent 3 hours looking at this, I've spent 2 hours, you have 2 minutes to tell me if you think this is fine. And then making them visually interesting, too. Between the photographers and the editors that I had help on some of the stories, my news director, Jeff Harris, and the general manager, Byron Grandy, for giving me the confidence and having the trust in me to do this and, for the most part, present them on my own and know that I fact-checked them and vetted them myself, and then I had someone, oh yeah, that looks cool. But the trust that both the station has given me and then the viewers for thinking that this stuff is good, too, as well as the judges. Thank you very much.
And in this same category, local station individual achievement, the judges also gave a special commendation for citizen engagement to Tom McKee of WCPO-TV, Cincinnati, Ohio. Tom traveled the state to record 135 questions from Ohio citizens that he then presented to candidates to answer in sit-down interviews. As a one-man shop, he videotaped the questions, set up the candidate interviews, wrote the scripts, and oversaw post-production. Judges noted that voters got the maximum benefit from his extensive field work. Let's see.
In this election, nothing is more important to Ohio's 11.5 million residents than creating jobs right here in the Buckeye State. And that's been the main focus of the two candidates who want to become Ohio's next U.S. Senator. They include Democratic incumbent Sherrod Brown and Republican State Treasurer Josh Mandel. Brown was born and raised in Mansfield and achieved the rank of Eagle Scout as a young man. He served 7 terms in the U.S. House of Representatives before being elected to the Senate in 2006. Here's how he chose to answer your questions.
I'm the owner of a small manufacturing company. The past 3 years, my profits have been reduced dramatically due to a 100% increase in my health care premiums. If elected, what will you do to help reduce these costs so I can put people back to work?
One thing that you could do in 2014 is join a healthcare exchange. In other words, throw in with a lot of other small businesses. So if you have one employee that gets really sick, and that causes your healthcare costs to skyrocket, you know, you've got a problem. But if you throw into a larger pool, if you will, in these healthcare exchanges with, you know, with thousands of other small businesses, hundreds of thousands of other small businesses of, you know, 10 to 50 to 100 to 500 employees, you can in some sense inoculate yourself.
It appears to voters like me that there's gridlock between Congress and the White House. What would you personally do to break that logjam?
Part of breaking this logjam and stopping this dysfunction is members of the Senate that will look for specific ways to work with both parties to advance a sports metaphor, to advance the ball over the goal line bipartisanly, which is always good for our country.
That's just a sampling of how Sherrod Brown responded to your questions. There's much more on WCPO.com/democracy2012. Tom McKee, 9 News in Columbus.
Tom McKee is here to accept this award for his work at Scripps-owned WCPO, an ABC affiliate. Tom?
I am certainly delighted and honored to accept this award for my achievements, but as Marshall said, I'd like to thank my colleagues at WCPO, certainly, and also the E.W. Scripps Company for the support in making this process and this program possible. A little background. In 1998, Frank Gardner, who was then the president of the TV division at E.W. Scripps Company, looked at some of the voter statistics and the election statistics across the country, and he became very discouraged. People weren't voting. They weren't registering to vote. And if they registered, they weren't voting at all. And of course, the negative ads were drowning out the information that voters needed to make informed decisions. They said, well, we have TV stations. What can we do? We're going to give candidates 5 minutes of free airtime in the 30 days before the election. During the newscasts, people said, you're crazy. You're going to ruin the ratings. You're going to take away advertising revenue from the stations. It didn't work out that way. So the first year we did it was 2000, and we did straight candidate interviews, and by all accounts, they were terrible, because you didn't get much information out of them because the candidates droned on and on and on, and it was hard to cut them off. 2002, Bob Morford became our news director. He had come to us from KNXV, the Scripps station in Phoenix. He handed me a tape of something they'd done out there and said, you can look at this as a model, you can look, do what you want with it, come up with your own program on how to do these. So we started in 2002, inventing a process which took hours and hours and hours just to get the people and the races and everything coordinated. Well, we did it 2, 4, 6, and 8. Well, I had photographers to shoot the interviews and this and that and the other, all the candidate material and do the editing. 2010, we'd gone to an MMJ, multimedia journalist format, so I started shooting all the questioners myself. We did 155 of them 2 years ago. Last fall, we did 135 of them in Ohio, Kentucky, Indiana for 15 different races. So what we ended up producing was 30 programs on air, 5-minute broadcasts that aired at the end of the 6 o'clock news, and 30 online, which ranged anywhere from 15 to 44 minutes, if you can believe that. So that's the process that we used to get to these particular programs. And have they been well received? Yes, I think they've been very well received because they give voters information that they can use right now, like so many other of my colleagues that have been honored in this way have done. So it's very flattering to that. It's very flattering, certainly to me, certainly to WCPO, my colleagues, especially the photographers that I've worked with, John Atkinson, Larry Deal, Scott Wagner, and Gary Hughes, who've done that for me over time. Our news directors, Bob Morford and Lane Michelson, who have encouraged me and allowed me to do this kind of work, and it took me away from day-to-day newscasts for quite some time. So that's the program. I'm very honored to that, but I have two other supporters I want to recognize. My son Mike's out here, and my biggest supporter and my biggest fan, my wife Claudia. Thank you for your support. Thank you very much for your time.
Our next category is for a local cable station, and this year we have two winners. First, Northwest Cable News, NWCN, Seattle, owned by Belo Corporation, wins for its analysis-heavy coverage and innovative production techniques. The station connected with voters through Google+, Facebook, and Twitter, proving the power of social media and new technology to engage citizens in the conversation.
The race for governor in Washington State promises to come right down to the wire, something voters here are quite familiar with. To that end, we brought in each candidate, Democrat Jay Inslee and Republican Rob McKenna, and asked them each the same five questions. Mr. Inslee won a coin flip to answer first, and we alternate responses from there on out.
The Idaho battles right now fit within the context of great discussions and debates across the nation.
Prop 1 ensures parents have input on teacher and principal job performances.
True. The law says annual teacher evaluations call for, quote, input from parents and guardians. Critics agree it's in the law, but say the ad is showcasing a very small part of Prop 1.
Well, a very small aspect of that law is, in fact, that the parents will have a voice in that.
I think there's a lot about these reforms that are very desirable, but as a parent and as a spokesman for this new group, I can say that that is one of the parts that we think is the most desirable and why Idahoans should vote yes in November.
Prop 1 also limits negotiated agreements between teachers and districts and ends renewable contracts.
You're interacting with the system here. You're not interacting with Facebook anymore. You are interacting with our system. Your data is coming to us, not Facebook. What our system does then is it takes a look to see if you're already registered. Is there someone with your name and date of birth already registered to vote? If there's not, you'll get this message here that says it doesn't look like you're registered to vote. Would you like to?
Tonight on Race to the Wire, we put you in the driver's seat. Viewers join us live in a Google Plus Hangout, Facebook, and Twitter for an interactive look at this election season. We want to head over to Rob from Bremerton now. He also has a question for our guest, Dwight Peltz. So what do you say, Rob?
Thanks for hanging with us, Dwight. I was curious if what Rob McKenna was going to be to Washington State like Mitt Romney was to Massachusetts.
Well, Mitt Romney was elected governor and Rob McKenna won't be, so that's one big distinction there. You know, we're trying to draw attention to the sort of the Rob, Romney, Ryan trio because we think these three have a lot in common, fast talkers with a lot of ideas that we don't think are good for your family.
Lynch and producer Charles Trillingham are here to accept the award for Northwest Cable News.
Thank you very much. You know, I worked at News Channel 8 in Washington for about 10, 11 years, and I thought Seattle was in the other Washington. Now that I'm in Seattle, I have come back to the other Washington. That's the way we look at it back there. And let me tell you something about NWC, because you may not know who we are, what we are. We have 2.9 million subscribers. We cover all of Washington, all of Oregon, parts of Idaho, a sliver of Montana, Alaska, and Northern California. We're one of the big five in regional cable news. News Channel 8's in there, New York One, the News 12 system out of Long Island, New England Cable News, and NWCN. And we are primarily aggregators of the great material that the stations in the VLO chain in the Northwest give us every day. King5 in Seattle, KGW in Portland, Krem in Spokane, KTVB in Boise. But we are also, even though we're a small newsroom, we're very efficient in originating content. To wit, 23 half-hour primetime specials that knitted the Northwest together on all of the different issues that were there. And another good piece of irony today is that the producer and originator of these shows is a graduate of the Murrow School, the Edward R. Murrow School at Washington State, and he has helped our station bring home a Cronkite. Charles, CBS is in the family, right?
Thank you, Wayne. As a producer, I have written down and rewritten multiple times what I was going to say. Much of it does not have active language, so I hope you'll forgive me for that, all the journalists and professors in the room. I would like to thank the Norman Lear Center at USC Annenberg and everyone involved with the Walter Cronkite Award for this tremendous honor for us at USC, and it is tremendous. I am a proud graduate of Washington State University in the Edward R. School, now College of Communication, where we learned the importance of dignity and integrity and accuracy and probably most of all depth in journalism. And I can promise you that myself and primary anchor Rob Piercy, who you saw there, Director Nicole Rogers, Assignment Manager Jennifer King, and the staff in the morning, the day, and the evening at NWCN all use those things with that in mind for every one of our specials. We could not have done this without the tremendous help of our analysts across the region. You saw Mr. David Adler there. He was in Boise State University. We also had Washington Policy Center. We had people at TVW who will be up here bit. We have people down in Oregon Political and the Washington Post, the Atlantic, Politico. All of these people who shared their time and shared their, you know, their precious resources with us. It was completely invaluable to get that. We also could not have done this possible without the tremendous leadership, Mr. Michael Valentine at BELO, Mr. Mark Ginther at King 5, and of course, my bosses, who gave me the freedom to do things like a Google Plus Hangout, which I don't believe they even knew what it was before I told them what it was. And we took a shot at it, Mr. Wayne Lynch and Mr. Dick Sklista, forever in your debt. Personally, I also need to thank my mother and father, Dave and Kathy, for all the missed phone calls, and my girlfriend Rachel for the 12, 13-hour days consecutively that left me completely wiped out on the weekends. I can promise you that us at NWC will wear this award as a badge of honor for our work in 2012, but also as a standard for our work going forward.
Mike. We'll celebrate on Tuesday with the staff, and thanks to BELO as being one of the great journalism broadcasting companies who still makes journalism a priority. Thank you all very much.
Our second local cable station winner is News Channel 8, Politico, WJLA, Arlington, Virginia. The station won praise for its in-depth, incisive reporting, its use of new technology, and its commitment to helping viewers understand how their election day choices affect their lives. News Channel 8 is a 24-hour cable news channel that operates as part of WJLA-TV and partners with Politico. It's a terrific example of what pooled, cross-platform resources can do. Let's look at the clip.
Everybody feeling good?
Yeah!
At Obama's Falls Church headquarters, a very specific rally cry.
All of you who have a stake in this election can't just sit around at home.
Asian American voters are being targeted in a way unlike the past. Customized signs and stickers in multiple languages, and on this day, some star power too, actor B.D. Wong.
It behooves the campaign, either campaign really, to reach out to these communities and speak to them in their own languages.
It's a big difference because there's a percentage of us who there's a barriers to English.
Are you surprised that you're seeing all this outreach?
Nope, no surprise at all.
All of that translates into
很重要，十一月份六号。
Get out and vote. Meanwhile, at the Eden Center, a different tune.
Hey, vote Romney.
Vote Romney, this small businessman says, a fan of lowering tax rates and not a fan of Obamacare.
I came from Vietnam. Everything is national life. That's why I don't like. And his idea tried to, I don't want to say communist, you know, but the idea is exactly the same.
Our vote this time is very important, even critical, may tip the balance.
Case in point, 2006, Jim Webb beats George Allen by 0.5%, and 3 out of 4 Asian Americans voted Webb. In 2008, they voted Obama over McCain by a margin of 3-1, and keep in mind their numbers have doubled to almost 14% of Northern Virginians.
We see that the power of the Vietnamese vote is really important.
And judging by the amount of posters and press, the campaigns see it too.
Bill Lord, Vice President and General Manager of WJLA News Channel 8, is here to accept the award for this All Britain Communications Owned ABC affiliate.
Thank you very much, and I am here to thank you on behalf of a collaborative group of political junkies across the river called Communications. We're over in Roslyn. We have the ABC affiliate, WJLA, for Washington, D.C. We have News Channel 8, which is our 24-hour local cable operation, which does an outstanding job every day. And we're in the same newsroom as Politico, which has a collection of what I would have to call the best political reporters under one roof anywhere in the country, perhaps the world. I don't want to sound too elaborate about that, but honestly, if you look at what these guys do every day, it's amazing. When we started collaborating during this election, it really didn't even feel like collaboration. We all started working together, and it really just felt like a team of people, reporters, going out and covering a story. And it felt that way throughout. Honestly, we were a little impressed with ourselves when we started looking at the results. and we are really honored to receive this award. To be honored for political reporting in Washington, D.C. is pretty amazing, and honestly, we look forward to this collaboration continuing for years and years to come in the future. So I want to thank all of the people who worked on this project, and particularly thank the Annenberg School for recognizing our work. So thank you very much.
And now I'm going to pass the mic to my good friend, USC Annenberg colleague, and esteemed veteran broadcast journalist, Judy Muller.
Thank you, Janine. Thank you. It's always wonderful to be part of this. I love the Cronkite Awards, and it's so inspiring to look at all of the entries and to see these winning entries, and I just love being part of it. So thank you for allowing me to be here. Our next category is for local public stations. Here the award goes to TVW, Washington State Public Affairs Network in Olympia. TVW is a nonprofit funded primarily by the Washington State Legislature and is one of the oldest public affairs networks in the country. TVW wins for its fair and visually compelling reporting on issues affecting the state. Judges singled out the station's in-depth examinations of coal exports and legalizing marijuana. Interesting combo. Take a look at the clip.
I'm Anita Cassay. For this Impact Special Report, TVW goes in-depth to give you a balanced look at the coal controversy and the burning questions about our potential as the coal shipping capital of America. What does a coal port actually look like up close, in person?
That's the line of the conveyor belt. So you take it from these piles all the way out there.
TVW travels to Canada to show you. Hear what it's like living with one in your backyard.
We're being blasted out of the northwest. Now we're going to be blasted out of the southeast.
It's just a matter of that's where it is and where you live.
How do we decide if and where coal should go here? What's in it for us? And should global concerns factor into our decision?
This is the example that we see here of what they're doing over there. This is what's really going on in China.
The coal is going to get shipped anyway, whether it's from Washington State ports or some other location in Canada, in Mexico, and somebody else is going to get those jobs.
A global controversy with Washington at the epicenter of this coal crossroads. It is one thing for us to talk about marijuana being legal here, but before we dig into the pros and cons of the issue, we want to show you exactly what people over 21 would be able to buy and how much. Rainier Wellness Center in Tacoma is for medical marijuana patients only. So unless you have a doctor's referral, you can't get this cannabis. But owner Dan Murdian gave us a rare glimpse behind the locked door for a quick show and tell lesson. If 502 were to pass and I were to come to your store that would be legally open, what would be the equivalent of 1 ounce of dried marijuana?
1 ounce? Okay. Basically what we have over here is a tested strain, and this is 28 grams. This is 1 ounce. This is what it looks like.
Now, even with the promise of all of that money that could come in from products like those, a lot of people still are not sold on this idea, even those who use the drug medicinally. Supporters hope more information will change more minds.
Here to accept the award is Greg Lane, president of TVW.
You can tell the difference between the talent and the suits because the suits need notes. Thanks very much, of course, to the Lear Center and the Annenberg School. TVW, as I mentioned on the panel and you heard, is the State Public Affairs Network. We're modeled after C-SPAN. We are public television, but we're not PBS, but in many ways, we have become a hybrid between what C-SPAN does and what local PBS stations do, providing gavel-to-gavel coverage of state government in Washington State, but also producing more in-depth, long-form pieces to give viewers a balanced, unbiased perspective and information about public policy issues in our state. We are really tremendously honored to be the first public affairs network to receive the Cronkite Award. We have been around for about 18 years. There are a number of states, and I want to acknowledge the work being done by state public affairs networks around the country in Connecticut, in Ohio, in Florida, in Pennsylvania. They also have thriving, robust state public affairs networks like TPW. I certainly also want to acknowledge my colleagues at TPW who actually produced this material that's being honored today. Mike Bay, who is our Vice President of Programming, Anita Cassay, who you saw in the reports up above, Christina Salerno and Austin Jenkins, who produce and host the public affairs programming content that we produce, Will Mader, Nate Shaw, Aaron Qualls, and the rest of our production staff behind the scenes, operating the cameras and doing the fantastic work editing, and then David Johnson, who runs our education and outreach division, which is also part of what the school is honoring with this award. We're very proud of their work. We're really pleased, and we really hope that this demonstrates the value of a state public affairs network, the role that it can play, a positive role in different states, and we hope that more states will step up and create networks like these to fill in some of the void that is existing in the lack of media coverage, particularly of state capitals and of state government issues. I want to also personally thank my wife Sarah and my children, represented by my son Griffin, who are with me today. Thanks for coming, guys. And then finally, I want to acknowledge Congressman Denny Heck, a freshman from Washington State, who 18 years ago was the co-founder of TBW, and it's really Denny's vision and foresight to create a state network, one of the first state networks to be created, that has grown into what TBW is today, a tremendous resource for Washington citizens, and who in this award, as you heard, the Annenberg Center described that Washington voters were lucky to have a station like TBW, and I couldn't agree more. So thank you very much for this award. Thanks.
And now we come to the Station Group Award, and that's a category, with two winners this year. Hearst Television garnered its seventh consecutive award for its comprehensive and extremely well-presented election coverage. Judges admired the station's group's use of the internet to complement broadcast coverage, including an election smartphone app. Let's take a look.
A political investigative unit.
So Missouri citizens aren't allowed in this poll, sir?
A partnership with PolitiFact.
This claim is false.
An election app.
Right in the palm of your hand.
A promise of 12 minutes a day of political coverage and more debates than any other station group. Hello, I'm Randy Price from Hearst Television's WCVB-TV in Boston. This political season required a greater need to sort the truth from the lies. So Hearst Television created two important initiatives in 2012. Commitment 2012 investigates and truth tests on the national level with PolitiFact. Add to that our increased daily commitment coverage in the 30 days leading up to the election, the creation of a Hearst election app, and candidate profiles and interviews, and you have the most in-depth political coverage in the country. Viewers in our markets went to the polls informed on the issues and able to discern fact from fiction in the important races in their cities, their towns, and in Washington.
After Massachusetts redefined marriage, local schools taught it to children in second grade, including the school our son attended. The courts ruled parents had no right to take their children out of class or to even be informed when this instruction was going to take place.
This claim is misleading. David and Tonya Parker are referring to a case where a second grade teacher read the class a book entitled King and King, in which two princes marry. The Parker son was in kindergarten at the time. He brought home a book called Who's in a Family? It was not required reading. It shows gay couples as part of a wide range of families headed by single parents, grandparents, interracial and heterosexual couples. The Parkers filed a lawsuit, but it didn't challenge the use of the books. They wanted the school to provide them prior notice so their son could opt out of class when the material came up. The case was dismissed. Court records indicate the Massachusetts parental notification statute requires public schools to notify parents whenever their children are being taught about sex or human sexuality. Court papers indicate the teacher was promoting the tolerance of different types of families, including those with same-sex parents.
And here to accept the award is Candy Altman, Vice President of News for Hearst Television.
honor to be here, and I'm here on behalf of 25 television stations around the country who produce that great work and who take incredible pride in being honored with the Cronkite Award. You know, I was thinking about, as we all are, about the Boston journalists who are in Boston right now, and the first responders. And I was thinking about the importance of politicians in a crisis like this, and their character, their ability to lead, and how what we do in elections helps the voters make those decisions. And as I was watching the coverage through the entire week in Boston, I was watching how the politicians were reacting and thinking, you know, how important it will be in future elections, how important it's been in the past to hold them accountable and to get to know them as people and to get to know their character and to understand their leadership style and how they would respond in these difficult situations. So on behalf of David Barrett, our chairman, Jordan Wortlieb, our president, Barbara Shore, my other colleague who's vice president of news, and the entire Hearst group, I thank you very much for this honor.
Our second station group winner is Belo Corporation, after a first-time winner in this category, for its engaging, clear, and extremely informative election coverage. Belo stations use an impressive variety of broadcast and interactive online formats to track races at all levels, local, state, regional, and national. Let's watch the clip.
Political coverage has always been a Belo hallmark, and for the 2 months leading up to Election Day 2012, Belo's 14 stations and four cable channels provided more than 300 hours of political coverage. We offer examples of ad watches and truth tests, enterprise reporting, social media, debates, weekly political shows and specials, free airtime for candidates to talk directly with voters, and travel around the country to provide local perspective to the national campaigns. Here's how the Belo stations covered the 2012 campaign.
Dixie Elixirs credits much of its success to location.
Colorado is absolutely the place to be right now.
State oversight of medical marijuana began nearly 3 years ago, but before that, businesses were unregulated.
These are all different strains.
Back Steve Horowitz opened Ganja Gourmet, which started as a restaurant.
And they ordered medicated pizza, and they had free medicated tapenade, which was really good.
But the city quickly banned on-site consumption, and state oversight soon followed, thanks in part to Matt Cook.
Every plant that you see in here has been accounted for.
The former narcotics officer helped write Colorado's strict regulations.
This is one of the barcodes.
Rules that force growers to document every plant from seed to sale.
And everything, 100% of what happens through the life of this process is on video.
From cameras to electricity,
so there's your temperature,
to heating and cooling,
and 1,200 parts per million CO2.
The high cost of getting into this business weeds out a lot of people, especially when you consider banks won't finance places that violate federal law.
You're coming in with your own money. I mean, you're looking at a $500,000 to $1 million investment to get one of these shops going now.
The state is now home to more than 500 dispensaries owned by so-called ganjapreneurs, or cannapreneurs. Green crosses light up Denver's South Broadway, which earned the nicknames Broadsterdam and Reefer Row. To many, the state system is a good foundation for voter-approved recreational marijuana, though not every dispensary plans to jump in.
We're going to choose to stay medical because we do have 400 patients, 500 patients that rely on what we do here, and we don't want to put ourselves at risk and their medicine supply risk.
Accepting for Belo Corp is Michael Valentine, Vice President of Content.
Thank you. I can't tell you how humble and honored I am to be here to accept this award and how appreciative I am from everybody at Annenberg School and the Lear Center. You know, from Seattle to Norfolk, from Boise to Dallas, the work our 14 television stations did this last year was really inspiring to all of us. The effort and dedication they put into telling the truth and fair and balanced reporting really means a lot. I speak for our CEO, Dunia Shive, and our president, Peter Diaz, and your vice president, Kathy Clements, when I tell you how honored we are to work with such extremely dedicated journalists in our company. You know, one person in this room actually had his hand in more of our political coverage than anybody else. And that's our chief photographer of our Washington, D.C. Bureau, Bryce Smith, who's standing in the back of the room, who spent tireless hours. We need a political set. We need a politician. We need to give him some time. And Bryce was there. You know, winning this award, I've had the pleasure and fortune of being involved in a lot of award processes. And winning this award was more complicated than my graduate school thesis, which really is a credit to the depth and seriousness of this award. You know, somebody in our company really galvanized all of our efforts, put it together in a cohesive fashion, and that's our news director in Northwest Cable News, Wayne Lynch. So Wayne, thank you. Now, I want to leave you by mentioning something that my dear friend at Hearst Candy said when she was on the stage an hour ago. You know, every company's responsibility is to give their journalists the guidelines, the access, and the support to do great work, and then turn it over to news directors like Albert, reporters like Marshall and Tom, and say, go create, be fair and balanced, be enthusiastic, and care. And it's just an honor to be up here and be around people who have done such great work. So thank you.
Turning the page. There we go. And let me add also that the judges were especially impressed that both Hearst and Belo made a top-down commitment to get their stations to air a significant amount of quality political journalism on a daily basis. Recognizing and encouraging this kind of commitment is the core mission of the Cronkite Awards, so congratulations to both. This year, instead of selecting a single regularly scheduled national news program, the Cronkite judges chose to give an award to the campaign coverage carried across the schedules of two network entrants. The first award for national network programming goes to BET, which not only informed African Americans about the candidates and issues, but also issued a call to action to potential voters. Let's take a look.
If we don't keep fighting for better jobs and better schools and a better future, who will?
If you want a president who will make things better in the African-American community, you are looking at it.
I'm Obama all the way.
He's doing a fabulous job.
He hasn't done anything.
Governor Romney is going to win.
Voter rights, education,
quality, affordable health care.
He's supporting gay marriage.
In this house, you are not going to be gay.
I want to work.
Our people are hurt.
He rescued this country from a depression.
We're tired of this corporate greed.
Who is held accountable for this?
This November, we get to decide.
Kane wowed the crowd.
Delighted to be here.
Pledging himself to the Tea Party agenda and his longtime political backers, the conservative activist billionaires, David and Charles Koch.
I am the Koch brothers' brother from another mother.
I started speaking at Tea Party rallies in 2009, before it was cool.
So those who say the Tea Party is racist or that they have an agenda that's against the minorities,
it's absolutely dead wrong. That many white people can't pretend to like me. Now, that being said, why don't you see more black people at a lot of the Tea Party events? This isn't meant to be flippant. They're working, if they have a job.
We are doing a voters registration drive, and we're just checking in the neighborhood to make sure that everyone's registered, and who's not registered, we want to help them to be registered. Are you registered?
No.
You're not?
No.
Oh, well, you're the perfect person. We've been looking for you. You go with them, Kim.
Are you registered to vote?
I'm a Democrat, yes. And I'm looking for to keep that man in that chair.
Yes,
considering my financial challenges, I felt that the way I could be most effective was to hit the streets and talk to people.
BET News requested interviews with both presidential candidates. President Obama granted our request. Governor Mitt Romney did not.
From day one, the president has governed within a perfect storm, a near economic collapse, bitter partisan politics, and often impatient demands from his own allies.
Take off your bedroom slippers. Put on your marching shoes.
The president minced no words at last year's Congressional Black Caucus dinner, telling the audience to stop letting race be a hindrance. It was in part his answer to critics who complained that the so-called post-racial president wasn't paying enough attention to Black America.
But our people are hurting.
There is a corner of Black America who wants you to sometimes say race is still a problem and really take that mantle on a little more than you have.
Well, I'm sure that there are folks who think that. There are a whole bunch of folks who think that everything I say has some racial element to it. And, you know, one of the things you learn as president is you're not going to make everybody happy at any given moment of the day all the time.
Accepting the award is Deborah Lee, Chairman and Chief Executive Officer of BET.
Thank you so much. Boy, that took us back a little way. It was a long campaign. I am so honored to accept this award on behalf of BET Networks. For several reasons. One, because it's named for Walter Cronkite, the most trusted man in America. And I grew up watching him on the nightly news, so it's very significant. Of course, when we told our town hall at work that we won this award, we had to realize that half the employees didn't know who Walter Cronkite was. So I'm showing my age, but we explain. We have a very young staff. And then second of all, it's so gratifying to have this from the Annenberg School at USC. One, because I've gotten to know the dean, Ernest Wilson, very well over the past 2 years, and that's because my daughter is a sophomore in the Annenberg School. So this is also very special to me personally. But I could go on and on about news coverage at BET and how we try to service our community, because it is very important to us. It's always been important to us. And we always have debates on how to best service our community since and our audience, since we're not a 24-hour news network. We're, you know, a cable network that does a lot of entertainment programming, but news is very important to our audience. And as you all know more than anyone, news is very hard to do these days between mobile devices and instantaneous information. So one of the things that we decided to do this year during the campaign was to produce these five specials and try to go in depth and really give our audience an in-depth view of the issues and let their voice be heard. And our news team, which is over to the right, wave, under direction of Larissa Jones, who you heard from earlier. Larissa and her team has done a terrific job in covering the issues and informing our audience. And we try to do three things with this coverage. One, to inform our audience of the issues and give them in-depth coverage of that. Two, to fight voter suppression, which was a huge issue in our community. And there was not a lot of talk about it in media in general, but it was very important to our audience. And we had to educate them about things that were being done to try to keep them from voting. And the third was, as you saw on the tape, to encourage them to get out and vote like their life depended on it. Because in the end, that's the most important thing, no matter who they voted for, that they get out and voted and stop the voter suppression efforts. So these specials did that very well. I have a very hardworking team. I really appreciate the fact that this award in the commentary, you said that the network poured our heart and passion into it, because we try to pour our heart and passion into everything we do, and especially news. And we know we have a unique perspective, and our audience trusts us. And when something happens, they come to us first. So we try to be there for them in whatever form we can between BET Network, Centric, and BET.com. So I'm very proud of the work we do from day to day, especially in the news area. And I can't thank you enough for recognizing the hard work that this wonderful team puts into it every day. Thank you very much.
Okay. Our second winner for national network programming is Univision, whose reporters were relentless in their approach to getting information during interviews with the presidential candidates. Though their questions were agenda-driven for the Latino community, every citizen could benefit from their journalistic rigor.
I have a question, an education question. According to the Pew Hispanic Center, there's 1.7 million undocumented students that could benefit from deferred action. It would enable them to go to college, join the military, and get working permits. One of the questions more frequently asked by Facebook users is whether you would keep deferred action for undocumented, yes or no?
These kids deserve something better than temporary. They deserve a permanent solution.
With all due respect, your reluctance to provide details on a permanent solution and that has created maybe a perception that you are kind of evading the question. What would you tell Hispanic voters right now if they actually are very interested in this important issue and all the dreamers that want to know if you become president, are you going to deport them or not?
Well, we're not.
Yes
we're,
or no?
We're not going to round up people around the country and deport them.
Yes. You're saying that you're not going to deport people, but on January 26th, you told me that you were in favor of self-deportation.
I believe people make their own choices as to whether they want to go home, and that's what I mean by self-deportation. People decide if they want to go back to the country of their origin and get in line legally to be able to come to this country.
Mr. President, I want to ask you something that is known as the Obama promise, and you knew that I was going to ask you about that. On May 28, 2008, we had a conversation in Denver, Colorado, and you told me the following, and I'm going to quote you. What I can guarantee is that we will have, in the first year, an immigration bill that I strongly support. I want to emphasize, the first year. At the beginning of your government, you had control of both chambers of Congress. And yet you did not introduce immigration reform. Before I continue, I want for you to acknowledge that you did not keep your promise.
Well, let me first of all, Jorge, make a point that when we talked about immigration reform in the first year, that's before the economy was on the verge of collapse. Lehman Brothers had collapsed. So,
promise, Mr. President. I am going to speak to English.
Because this is very important. I don't want it to get lost in translation.
Si.
You promised that.
Si.
And a promise is a promise. And with all due respect, but you didn't keep that promise.
Well, here's what I would say, Jorge. We have to have cooperation from all these sources in order to get something done. And so I am happy to take responsibility for the fact that we didn't get it done, but I did not make a promise that I would get everything done 100% when I was elected as president.
Accepting. Lourdes Torres, Director, Special Projects for Univision Network, and Daniel Mocate, Chief Managing Editor at Univision News. Boy, it's a lot for me.
First of all, I have to say I'm another Lourdes. Lourdes Torres couldn't make it today. I'm Lourdes Medusa, correspondent here in Washington. I'm delighted to be in her place today. On behalf of everyone at Univision News, we want to thank the Norman Lear Center and the USC School of Communication and Journalism for this award. It makes us all especially proud because it carries the name of an icon in journalism. Our election coverage involved many long hours, as you may guess. We have less resources than other networks, but it was driven by a stubborn commitment to keep our audience well-informed and motivated to participate in the election. And many of them did, we're proud to say. The goal was shared, of course, from everyone from our crews in the ground to our management. President of News, Isaac Lee, and Vice President Daniel Coronel were extremely pushy for us to strive for excellence. And this was especially true in the case of the two town hall meetings that we held with President Obama and with Governor Romney. I want to thank you in particular on behalf of Lourdes Torres, who is the Director of Special Projects, and she was the point person for all the election coverage, and Patsy Loris, our news director, with us here, Daniel Coronel, who is Daniel Morcate, who is basically the brain in our news, and he's in charge of content and was in charge of content for the two town hall meetings. Of course, our anchors, Marilena Salinas and Jorge Ramos, worked so very hard on this, and they made it look so effortless. When I first came to Washington 20 years ago, most of the calls that I made to sources required that I spelled Univision. We've come a long way, and we thank you, and we are very humbled and honored by this recognition, and we are so proud to be in the company of these journalists tonight, today.
Our final category today is National Individual Achievement. And the winner is Jonathan Carl of ABC News. Jonathan won for his original analysis of complex topics and his probing, highly effective interviews of presidential primary candidates. With his unique style, he got candidates to relax, but he never backed away from tough questions. He was unrelenting in getting the facts. Let's watch the clip.
I made a big mistake in the spring.
Haven't we had enough mistakes?
Nearly half of all political ads here, some 45% of them, have been negative against Newt Gingrich. It's been a pile-on, and Gingrich has not hit back.
We're gradually going to have to figure out how to essentially take apart the negative ads. I mean, I am committed to running a positive campaign, and we have to find a way to communicate. You know, because I just think politics has become a really nasty, vicious, negative business. And I think it's disgusting. And I think it's dishonest. And I think the people who are running the ads know they're dishonest. And I think a person who'll do that to try to get to be president offers you no hope that they'll be any good as president.
And what if he runs against Obama?
So if you're the Republican nominee, no negative ads against Barack Obama?
You don't have to be negative about Barack Obama. Just tell the truth. More people have gotten food stamps under Barack Obama than ever before in American history. If you think that's an achievement, he'd be a good president.
Last night, we told you about Senator Marco Rubio, the Republican senator from Florida. Well, today, he was at the center of a hairpin turn this morning after ABC's John Carl reported that Rubio was apparently not being vetted for a spot on the ticket as vice president. The Romney camp must have heard it, because by late this afternoon, a change. Here's John Carl.
He may be the Republican Party's fastest rising star, most prominent Hispanic, and as Mitt Romney saw just yesterday, the mere mention of Rubio's name draws applause from Republican activists.
I saw Marco Rubio the other day. We were together at a rally.
Knowledgeable Republicans told ABC News that Romney hasn't even asked Rubio to take the first step towards being considered a vice presidential candidate. No documents have been turned over, no questionnaires filled out. The Obama team accuses Bain of shifting American jobs overseas, but most of that allegedly happened after Romney says he left the company in 1999.
I had no role whatsoever in the management of Bain Capital after February of 1999.
But filings with the Securities and Exchange Commission list Romney as CEO and president of the company until 2002.
So you bear no responsibility for what happened to that company, even though those SEC forms list you as chairman and the chief executive officer and president of the company?
The ownership shares of the company were ownership shares which I retain. But when I left Bain Capital in February of 1999, I went out to run the Olympics.
We're fortunate that John could tear himself away. It's a busy news day to accept his award. Jonathan Carl.
This is the craziest news day of, I think, my career outside of the immediate aftermath of September 11th. So, but I wanted to be here. It was so incredibly honored to win this award. And watching those clips, it's like a time capsule. Let me tell you, Newt Gingrich got around to negative ads. And the percentage of ads that were negative against Newt went from 45% to 99% in Florida. So things changed as that campaign went along. It was just a real honor to win this award, first of all, because I've just, the name Walter Cronkite, I am still, you know, old enough and young enough to think that that name is just, it's a real incredible honor to me and to my team. And I got to tell you, to be receiving this award with so many incredible other recipients, Brooks Jackson, who I got to work with at CNN, and Univision. How about those interviews with Romney and with Obama? Those were two of the best town halls of the entire campaign. But the real reason I'm here is to say this award is not for me, this is for my team. I have been blessed to work with some of the best people in the business. Most of them are busy working here today and have totally blown me off, you know? I mean, I don't know what else is going on. But we do have, well, we do have two, Avery Miller and Gregory Simmons-Lamos, who are here today, part of what we call Team Carl. I'm honored by you putting my name on our team, and so that really meant a lot to me. But Robin Gradison, who is busy today working, this is also a big part of this. We traveled all around the country. We did countless interviews. It was so amazing to be able to have an award that isn't about one story, but it's about the cumulative effort. And this effort was absolutely amazing. I also, one other thing, Martha Raddatz is not here, but the highlight of the campaign for me was to be able to help work with Martha Raddatz to prepare for that vice presidential debate. So thank you for honoring my colleague and great friend Martha Raddatz as well, and my family who could be here, my wife Maria, who put up with God knows how much. Maria, thank you for being here. I threatened to make Maria accept the award on my behalf if I couldn't be here. And my dad and Wendy, thank you, came up from Florida for this. A tremendous honor, thanks to Ben Sherwood, the president of ABC News, who made it all possible, and my incredible anchors I work with, especially Diane Sawyer and George Stephanopoulos. Thank you.
As you know, Martha Raddatz couldn't get here today, but she is receiving a special commendation for debate moderation for her work in the vice presidential debate. She proved to be an active moderator who struck the right balance between facilitating and shaping the debate. Martha posed excellent questions, asks for specifics, and worked to keep the candidates on point. Let's watch.
Good evening and welcome to the first and only vice presidential debate of 2012. I would like to begin with Libya. On a rather somber note, 1 month ago tonight, on the anniversary of 9/11, Ambassador Chris Stevens and three other brave Americans were killed in a terrorist attack in Benghazi. The State Department has now made clear there were no protesters there. It was a pre-planned assault by heavily armed men. Wasn't this a massive intelligence failure, Vice President Biden? I just want to talk to you about right in the middle of the crisis. Governor Romney, and you're talking about this again tonight, talked about the weakness, talked about apologies from the Obama administration. Was that really appropriate right in the middle of the crisis? Okay, on to taxes. If your ticket is elected, who will pay more in taxes? Who will pay less? And we're starting with Vice President Biden for the surge troops that we put in there. And you brought this up, Congressman Ryan. I have talked to a lot of troops. I've talked to senior officers who were concerned that the surge troops were pulled out during the fighting season, and some of them saw that as a political move. So can you tell me, Vice President Biden, what was the military reason for bringing those surge troops home?
The military reason for bringing up, by the way, when the president announced the surge, you'll remember, Martha, he said the surge will be out by the end of the summer. The military said the surge will be out. Nothing political about this. Before the surge occurred, so you be a little straight with me here, too. Before the surge occurred, we said they'll be out by the end of the summer. That's what the military said. The reason for that is...
The military follows orders. There are people who are concerned about pulling out.
There are people that are concerned, but not the Joint Chiefs. That was their recommendation in the Oval Office to the President of the United States of America.
Well, let's talk about this 20%. You have refused, and again, to offer specifics on how you pay for that 20% across-the-board tax cut. Do you actually have the specifics, or are you still working on it, and that's why you won't tell voters?
accepting on Martha's behalf to ABC producers Avery Miller and Gregory Levis.
So we actually are Team Carl, missing one. Team Carl. Yeah. Martha couldn't be here because she might actually be on the air as we speak. But she sent a message, which is, she just said the debate was an amazing experience for her, and that she was honored to have received this award. As John mentioned, it took a team, a village, to prepare for the debate. Rick Klein, Robin Sproul, our bureau chief, John Carl, Devin Dwyer, Sarah Jess, and Sarah Parnas. And just as colleagues of Martha, watching her, my office is on the same floor, a few feet away from her, and she showed incredible determination preparing for this debate, and did it without any of the vanity that so often trickles into network news. She is an incredibly nice person, as is John Carl. He's not here, but having spent a lot of time on the road with him, you just don't find people that are as delightful as Martha and John are to work with in our business. And also just say, you know, watching Martha that night was a little bit like watching a wonderful sporting event where you're cheering for the referee. She made the entire ABC family so proud, and you really can't say enough nice things about her. She's just so intelligent and kind and tough. I don't know if you want to say anything else about her.
All I was going to say is she's also a wonderful mentor to working mothers. Gregory's on maternity leave, and John Carl actually has a job share, two mommies, and we share the producer job. And so both of them have been wonderful mentors to working mothers. So absolutely, we appreciate it, and thank you so much.
Oh, and I'm supposed to sit down. It says it right here, Geneva.
It's hard to get her to sit down, you know, but I want to thank all of you for being here today on behalf of the Annenberg Public Policy Center and USC Annenberg and the Norman Lear Center. I want to congratulate all of you extraordinary winners. It's been a wonderful event, and I think now we must go forth and do great work like this we have seen, and we'll see you in 2015. Thank you so much.